Hi, I'm Nikki. Welcome to iHeart Game Dev, a channel about game development. This is a video in a series dedicated to learning Unity's animation system. In the previous video, we learned to retarget animations using Unity's avatar system and humanoid rigs. Today, we're going to learn how we can use Unity's avatar system in combination with animation layers in order to control different parts of the character body. If you want to show some support, like the video, subscribe, and let's get started. Let's start with an example. Say we have a character who is able to stand, walk, and run. We want this character to be able to aim a weapon while in any of the movement states. How can we solve this? When first creating a new animator controller, we open to the base layer, which is at the heart of the animation. If we do not create any other layers, the base is all that will matter. By adding additional layers, we can create new animation states that will either completely replace or add to the base layer's animations. To enhance this feature even further, we are able to designate which bones from our new layers we actually want to use. So for our example with the equipping of the weapon, we can say, okay, let's keep the base layer's legs and torso movement, but we'll add a new layer called arms. The arm layer will perform the arm movements we are looking for. So to sum it up, we are layering new animations over the original base layer, which can override certain bones and perform different animations. Let's begin today's demo project by getting set up. Heading to mixamo.com, we'll download all of the free animations we'll need for today's project. We'll start by selecting the YBot character and download an idle animation, a walk animation, and a run animation. To ensure everyone's on the same page, here are our usual settings, with skin being optional after we have at least one animation that includes the skin. Also, let's remember to toggle the in-place checkbox for all the animations that have the option. Next, we'll download the pistol idle animation where the character isn't moving, a crouch idle animation, an injured idle, injured walking, and injured running animations. Some animations of these may not include the in-place option, but that's actually not an issue in today's lesson, so we'll download it anyway. For a full breakdown of these Mixamo settings, feel free to check out my first tutorial on the channel. Opening Unity, we'll import our downloaded files by dragging them into the project folder. Highlighting our idle animation, we'll see four tabs: Model, Rig, Animation, and Materials. Let's press the Rig tab, switch Animation Type to Humanoid, and press Apply. We will do this for each animation we just downloaded, except with the avatar definition setting, we'll choose Copy from Other Avatar, and select the avatar we just created for the original animation. Setting the rig type to humanoid is what we typically do to reuse animations between our bipedal characters. This was thoroughly explained in the previous video about animation retargeting. However, there are actually many other benefits to using this system, and today we'll be exploring one of them known as animation layers. Okay, now that our character is of type humanoid, we'll start by dragging the model into the scene hierarchy, placing it at the world origin. Next, let's add a new animator controller titled Layers Demo Animator. If our character didn't automatically add an animator when we added it to the scene hierarchy, we can do that now and select this animator controller from the circle selector and the avatar associated with the character. Duplicating our walk animation, we'll select the loop time checkbox in the inspector window so that the animation will loop. Next, we'll drag the animation into the Animator Grid, which will automatically set it as the default animation state. Pressing play, we'll see that our YBot character will start walking. Awesome! But nothing we haven't seen before. Let's get into layers. In the Layers tab, we'll press the plus button and rename our new layer to Aiming. We will immediately notice that the grid has reset to the original three nodes, and the title of the layer is set in the label right above the grid. So far, this layer does absolutely nothing, because it doesn't have any animations. Let's add our pistol idle animation as the default animation state for this layer, and press play. It seems like nothing is happening, but we can see our animation state being played. In our list of layers, we'll notice a gear icon for each layer. Pressing the icon on our aiming layer will reveal a submenu with six total settings: weight, mask, blending, sync, timing, and IK pass. Let's begin to break these down. Starting from the top, Weight determines the percentage of influence a layer has on our character. That is to say, when the weight is zero, as it currently is, the layer will have zero impact on our character's animation. But as we increase the weight of the layer, we will see that the animation starts to take over. When we are at a full weight of 1, our character will only be performing this animation or any animations deeper in the list that have weight. Regarding layer priority, the lower the layer is on the list, the higher the priority the layer's animations will have over those above them. Okay, cool. Now we know to set our weight to 1 when we want our aiming animation to play. But this doesn't solve our issue. As we can see, the entirety of our walking animation is replaced when we increase the weight of the aiming layer. We only want the arms. This brings us to our next setting in the gear menu, Avatar Mask. In our project tab, we'll right click, select create, and press on Avatar Mask. We'll see and open the two dropdowns in our inspector, Humanoid and Transform. The Humanoid dropdown now displays a green silhouette of a character and a few points reading IK. Here, we are seeing the selected bones that are to be included in the layer. If we press on an area of the body, we can see the color change from green to red. These bones will be left out of the animations in the layer. Let's give this a test by deselecting the legs. Before we enter play mode, we need to remember that simply creating the mask isn't enough. We need to set the mask reference by using the circle selector in the layer settings for it to actually impact our character. Entering play mode now, we'll see that as we increase the weight, our character starts to aim and continues to walk. Awesome! As for the other settings on the avatar mask, the IK markers stand for inverse kinematics. As stated by the Unity docs, toggling the markers will either include or exclude the IK curves used in the layer's animations. To better understand this, let's think of a typical IK example, proper foot placement on uneven ground. When each foot is on the ground, we'll want the foot to rotate and match the ground's rotation, and when it's not, we want it to lose the rotation adjustment. In order to know when the foot is on the ground, we slowly go through the animation and modify the curve so that it's at a higher value when the foot is on the ground and a lower value when it's in the air. I plan on exploring IK further in the future, but for today, we simply need to understand that these animation curves are completely ignored when the markers in the avatar mask are deselected. Below the humanoid settings, we have transforms. Selecting your character avatar and pressing Import Skeleton, the transform list will fill out with the entire bone hierarchy of our humanoid character. This list allows us to select any extra bones our character may have, such as tails or wings, allowing us to choose if we want them to be included in the layer or not. Humanoid bones are not impacted by the transforms list. Those bones are exclusively handled in the humanoid settings above. Taking this back to the gear menu, we've now covered the weight and the mask settings. Next, we have blending. Blending has two options, additive and our current setting, override. Override will prioritize the animation over the layers above it on the list. In our example earlier, our walking animation typically includes animations for both arms. However, because we were using an override blending setting and our aiming avatar mask had the arm selected, the arm's animation from the aiming layer were prioritized over the base layer. The additive option is a little more complex. In an animation, we store the transform data for each bone. Additive is intended to combine this data from all layers that have additive selected. The higher the weight, the more noticeable it will be. A basic example of additive can be seen here, where we have three layers, the base layer where the weapon is being held in an idle position, and two additional layers controlling the vertical and horizontal movement of the torso and arms. This control is done by using separate blend trees and an upper body avatar mask. In the vertical blend tree, we have two separate animation poses which just point the weapon up and down. And in the horizontal blend tree, the poses are to the left and the right. Testing this implementation, we can see that changing the parameter values for our aim horizontal and aim vertical has our character aiming in a combination of all four directions. This is because we are adding each layer together. Hence the name additive. What happens if we switch to override on our deepest layer? We'll find that our horizontal axis is moving. And if we switch the vertical layer to override and move it beneath the horizontal layer, now our character will only aim vertically. But again, with additive layers, we are able to combine multiple layers together up until we reach another override layer. Now again, additive layers can be quite tricky. Our example here works properly because our idle position has the same upper body pose as the four other animations. What happens if the animation in our override layer doesn't share the same pose as the additive animations? Switching the current weapon idle animation in our override layer to a simple walking animation, we'll see that our walking looks fine, but the character's arms now look a little funny. This is due to how the additive system works. Animations have what's known as an additive reference pose. By default, this is frame 0 of the animation, but it's adjustable in the FBX animation tab and the debug inspector settings. Additive animations apply the difference in bone transforms between this reference pose and the current frame. To explain this, let's look at our example. The reference pose for each animation in our two blend trees are all set to frame 0 of the weapon idle animation. Our weapon idle animation is looking straight and holding the weapon in hand. If we look at our four animations included in our blend trees, they are nearly identical to the weapon idle animation. The difference is that they each rotate the torso 90 degrees in their respective directions. So what these additive layers are doing is applying the differences between the reference pose and the current frame to the previous layers. In this case, we can see the difference is just the torso rotation. Here's another setup to demonstrate the power of additive animation layers. Take this crouched idle animation. Looking at the animation, it has over 30 frames. We can actually save some space and increase performance with additive layers. Deleting all keyframes except for keyframe 0 in the crouched animation, and then copying keyframe 0 from the standing idle animation, we can paste it inside our crouching animation and set it as the reference pose. Previewing this animation, our character interpolates between the standing position and our crouch position with just two keyframes. We can then create a new animation layer, set the blend type to additive, and add this modified animation as the default animation state. Entering play mode and changing the weight, we can see our character crouching up and down with an animation that's just two keyframes. Pretty amazing. Returning to our gear settings menu, we see a checkbox titled Sync. Pressing this toggle, the layout of our grid is changed, and we have a new dropdown menu titled Source Layer that defaults to our base layer. This dropdown lists all other created layers. The sync toggle copy and paste the entirety of the source layer's node setup into the new layer. If we delete a node in either layer, it's deleted in all layers that are synced to the same source. So how is this useful? Let's imagine a simple base layer that includes three states: idle, walk, and run. And in our imaginated game, we have some sort of health system. We might have some UI that just shows the current health as a number, which is pretty standard, but we can also show the player that their health is low by using different animations. Say we have an injured version of the idle, walk, and run. We can create an injured layer, activate the sync toggle, and select the respective injured animations in each animation state. Now all we would have to do is set the layer weight based on the normalized value of the player health. Pretty sweet, right? When activating sync, we also make the timing settings selectable. Unity's documentation states, the timing checkbox allows the animator to adjust how long each animation in sync layers takes, determined by the weight. If timing is unselected, then animations on the sync layers will be adjusted. But to demonstrate this, let's take our walking animation and duplicate it. Call the duplicate Fast Walk. We'll modify the playback of the animation to play at double the speed by increasing the sample rate to 60 from the current 30. Next, we'll place our regular walk in the base layer as the default state, and then create a new layer called Fast Walk, and turn on sync with the base layer. We will see the same walking state, but we'll set the motion to our fast walk. Entering play mode, our default layer plays our walk animation state. By increasing the weight of our fast walk layer, we'll see that nothing changes. However, pressing the timing toggle on this layer, our character starts to play back at the faster speed. So to reword the descriptions from the Unity docs, when the timing toggle is active, animations in our sync layers will play normally and at their own rate. When the timing toggle is inactive, Unity will try to fit the keyframes of the synced layer into the same sample rate and animation timeline length as the source layer. The last setting that we'll be covering today is IK Pass. This toggle will activate and deactivate inverse kinematics. More specifically, it activates and deactivates the onAnimatorIK function in any scripts that are attached to the same game object as the animator. Here is a basic implementation of IK provided by the Unity docs for the head and the right arm. When we activate IK pass in our base layer, we'll see that our character's head and arm immediately point in the direction of the two spheres, and as we move the spheres around, the arms and the head follow. Awesome! This is just scratching the surface of IK, a topic we plan to cover in the future. Amazing job today! If you like what you learned, please consider pressing the like button and subscribing to the channel. It really helps the channel out and tells me that we're covering content that you care about. In the next video, we'll learn to use animation-based events. And soon enough, we'll get our character moving with rigid body physics. If you'd like to join a growing community, I'd be happy to see you in the channel Discord. And if you want updates on the next video, feel free to follow me on Twitter. But that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.